you hear me over there? Lancaster, Loughborough. Can you see slides of presentation? And do you see the second one with visualizer? Yeah, a pen there, right? Can you see? Okay, good. As was suggested by questionnaire students in the questionnaire, I shall use visualizer. So instead of waving hands around, so I can put some exact formulas on the paper, and that will be helpful. So I think it's a sensible suggestion, so I'm going to use it. Let's come back to the subject of our course. And because it was 2 weeks since we met last time, I think we may benefit from a brief recap of what was done so far. So we are starting to learn the representation of the Heisenberg group and a bit of general theory. Whenever you have a representation of any group in vector space, and this group is a smooth one, admitting corresponding Lie algebra as generators of continuous one-parameter subgroup, you may produce with derivation of this representation, and that derived representation will correspond, produce certain possibly unbounded operators for the elements of the Lie algebra. So that was the general theory which we considered a bit. Then second analysis operation is integration. That is meaningful if we are integrate over invariant measure. And for non-commutative group, we shall take care either that measure invariant under left or right shifts. Fortunately for the Heisenberg group, this is not an issue, because Heisenberg group is unimodular, so the left and right invariant measure coincide, and moreover, they coincide with the, our very well-known and usual Lebesgue measure, which is invariant under usual shift in corresponding Euclidean space. When having such a measure, we define operation of convolution on the group, and we define also the representation for functions. So that is formula 30. We take a function and integrate it along with the representation rho, which we have for the group. That integral expression which we are integrating is operator valued. And then we may ask, what is the meaning of this integral for operator valued expressions? That one of possibility to make sense, it's in a weak sense, so-called integral. We just take an inner product with some vectors in our dual space, and then I will use my new toy visualizer to write it down. So whenever I am integrating a function a of t, which is operator valued with respect to t, so to make sense, I pick up two vectors v from my vector space and some f from the dual space, then consider the integral where I take the scalar value now, applying operator to the vector and pairing with the, so this is the dual space, this is functional from the dual space. So that now expression under integral is the expression on the integral is just a scalar, and that integration may be done straightforward way. Whenever we have a corresponding value of the scalar integral for all combination of V and F, we may rebuild the operator value integral through the usual theory of vector space and their duals. So that is a technique how to make sense of integration of representation in particular. And straightforward algebraic calculation shows that convolution algebra on the group by this integration is mapped to corresponding operator algebra corresponding to the functions. When we introduced the concept of covariant transform, that is essentially application of the certain functional to our operator, which consists a representation of the group. And the meaning, important meaning of the covariant transform, what instead of arbitrary abstract vector space in which our representation of the group is acting, we are mapping with vectors from abstract vector space to the functional space on the group. So image of the covariant transform are certain function on the group. And when our representation, the main result about intertwining property for this representation is that when we produce that covariant transform, we intertwine given representation rho with the left regular representation, or rather with sub-representation of the left regular representation. In this sense, any representation which we started from, again, it may be in any space, in the abstract one, or quite maybe remotely connected to the group initially, but after the covariant transform, it became a representation which acts by shift on the group. So that is great unification of theory of because all representations now may be treated in this way as sub-representation of left shifts, and we may easily compare different representation acting in different spaces just by transferring them back to the group and see is it the same or not a representation on the group. So that is a great advantage of that technique. When just particular case of that general approach is very well known wavelet transform or voice transform which used in the signal processing in the engineering questions, and it's usually associated with shifts and dilations. So that is wavelet transform which we have in this situation. And further, it's not only engineering application. The familiar Cauchy integral formula on the real line may be obtained exactly in the same way with a function which is given in the last line. Now, let's come back from general theory of covariant transform. Some results which we stated before are of general nature. Let's see what it will happen if we apply the technique to the Heisenberg group. So we already built before through either co-adjoint representation of the Heisenberg group or by induction in the sense of Mackey, we constructed a different representation. One of them is a representation which called Schrödinger in connection with quantum mechanics. This is a representation on functions defined on the real line. So for simplicity, we are considering function H1, we consider group H1, but a similar representation may be done for n-dimensional Heisenberg group. And then representation will act in corresponding n-dimensional Euclidean space. But formulas became almost identical in that more general case, so we don't lose generality, consider H1 for simplicity here. So typically, as the mother wavelet for so formula is 36, which generate which represents such a transformation in for an arbitrary function we note, but for some reasons which we learned soon, there is a very special function Gaussian. So well, Gaussian is the object which appear in different as in different theories from different backgrounds, and Why it's appear in connection with the Heisenberg group, we are learn very soon. So we are prefer that Gaussian normalized as follow. So we put pi and some Planck constant in front of x square in the exponent, and that also will produce a certain simplification to our formulas. In particular, we don't need to put square roots of pi in front of integral. So really, if pi itself is quite important and meaningful quantity, geometrically representing a relation between diameter and the length of the circle, but square root of pi is something which I consider not very nice and without particular meaning. So to avoid square roots of pi, so it's better to put pi in the exponent. So in this case, we substitute Mother wavelet to be Gaussian, and formula simplifies or take the expression 37. And that is, again, very important expression. Integral transform of this type, we will again meet it again in more context, more quantum mechanical context later, but it's known as Fock-Siegel-Bargmann transform, and it is an integral operator which intertwine two pictures, two models of quantum mechanics. One is the Schrödinger model on the real line, and the second one is Fock-Siegel-Bargmann representation, which act on the phase space. So a real line can may be considered as configurational space of a quantum particle, and phase space model have some nice features, which we discuss later. Well, coming back to that, probably I need to enlarge my presentation. Yes, so if you will analyze that formula, you will see what element of the Heisenberg group from the center S act very trivially in that expression. In fact, we are integrating over x dash. X dash is not paired to S. So S is just produce an exponential factor, which may be taken out of the integral. So that factor, highlight too much. That factor is just taken out of the integral, produce a constant term, which is not essentially related to behavior of function F, or do not affect much the behavior of the resulting function. So that is somehow excessive elements in this transformation, and we may think a little bit more of the nature of that element here. So to modify our definition of covariant transform to get rid of such trivial factors, we may note the following case, the situation which happened in this particular expression. So we have, again, a function of the covariant property 38, which we already know from the induced representation. So when we are considering induced representation on the group, we are considering function with a certain property like that. So assume our fiducial operator F has the property with respect to certain subgroup H tilde, given by this identity. That tell us what action of representation rho is really multiplication by a character in this situation, and when it's maybe trivially put out of the integral. And so in particular, we are considering a situation with the traditional wavelet transform, and when we may note what, for example, our representation with the Heisenberg group has that property of Mother wavelet again. So we have representation which act by multiplication as a character. When applying or using that property in the formula for covariant transform, we may verify what entire covariant transform is multiplied by the corresponding character chi as well. So if we have left shift, then we have with multiplication in the case of that property. And that turn out what the representation which we obtain as a left sub-representation of the left regular representation on the group is really induced by corresponding character of subgroup H tilde. So here is important observation what subgroup H tilde may be different from the subgroup H. So initially we may build our induced representation on out of the certain subgroup H, but we'll be able to find our mother wavelet which has the required property with respect to certain different subgroup H tilde. When it's turned out that covariant transform in this case will be intertwining operator between two representations induced from different subgroups. That is will happen in our study of the Heisenberg group. In our consideration before, we classify all one and two dimensional subgroups. We find essentially three different situations, and when we build three different form of representation. But as we will see later, all of them are essentially equivalent, are intertwined by certain operators, and that intertwining operators exactly appear as a realization of covariant transform with suitable mother wavelets. So here is a discussion of this effect. So again, if we have covariant transform which intertwine the representation induced from subgroup H tilde, then we can use the corresponding technique of induced representation and consider our covariant transform, which previously was a function on the entire group, now to the function on the homogeneous space only. So the steps which we are taking in that procedure will be as follow. We have initially representation rho on a certain space V. When by means of the covariant transform we map it as a sub-representation of the left representation lambda on G, and then by analyzing the properties of our mother wavelet we are able to reduce it to the induced representation say rho 1 on the corresponding homogeneous space over subgroup H tilde. So this is steps which are performed in our case, and in particular we may note what for any representation of the Heisenberg group action of the center will be always trivial. So the center Z shall act as multiplication by a character, so any mother wavelet always for any irreducible representation would be just multiplication by a character. So we may reduce our representation to the case the representation induced from the character. So that is in fact presented here in the formula 41, And we now get the first meaning and or the first outcome from the constructed Wavelet transform. We established what Fock-Siegel-Bargmann transform is an identifying operator between Schrödinger representation, and Schrödinger representation was induced from the two-dimensional subgroup of the Heisenberg group to the representation induced by the center of the Heisenberg group, so that is induced by one-dimensional subgroup. So this is the first significant meaning of Fock-Siegel-Bargmann integral transform. Next, if we repeatedly meet functions which has a certain covariant property, namely action or shift from the right by element of the subgroup is resulting in the multiplication by a character, we may introduce the corresponding averaging operator. So this is operator A related to a character chi, which we introduce on this slide. So we integrate our function, we average our function over subgroup H using that character as a weight for averaging. Then very straightforward verification check is that averaging operator has the following properties. First of all, a result after averaging will be functions which has that covariant property with respect to subgroup H. So multiplication of the argument from the right is resulting to the multiplication of the value of function by corresponding character. So that is what we know for our functions, is a transformation between domain, so shift on the domain from the right is resulting to certain multiplication in the range. Correspondingly, image of our averaging operator is an invariant subspace under left shift. So we may reduce left regular representation to this space and obtain a sub-representation. And that sub-representation will be, of course, the representation which is induced by the character which was used for averaging. Next, if we have a function, L1 function on the group, and this is function K1, and consider a function K2, which is a result of the averaging, then convolution will be of these two functions, will be a function which already pass the averaging. This is just came out from the associativity of convolution operator. And when that means what the collection of averaged functions not only make a subspace, it's also make an ideal in the term of algebra. So that is an ideal in our convolutional algebra. Second property, what averaging has the identity, satisfied to the identity of the projection. So application of averaging twice is just the same as a single averaging. So it's a projection to corresponding ideal. And last property is that if we make the representation, if we consider integral representation associated with representation induced by a character chi, then the result of representation for function and its averaging will be the same. Why this property happen? Again, it's a straightforward verification by some associativity of integrals, but the reason is that induced representation has character of subgroup H in its heart, and when you integrate over it, you are doing really wet averaging. So averaging is already hidden in the integrated representation induced by this character, and so you are applying averaging just twice, which is identical to single application of the averaging. Now, in relation with the averaging, we may consider the following connection between averaging and convolution. We already noted that averaged function make an ideal with respect to convolution. Now we want to come back to that diagram which we continuously use in our discussion when we have a homogeneous space with respect to subgroup H. When we are considering lifting, we map our function by means of the lifting from the homogeneous space to entire group. When we produce certain operation on the group, which maybe is a left shift, or maybe we consider convolution on the group, and when we pull back our operation to homogeneous space again. So that making that diagram commutative, that corresponds to certain operation on homogeneous space. So if we are considering here on the group the convolution operator between function, then on the homogeneous spaces it will be corresponding operation which called the twisted convolution. Twisted convolution for particular reasons which are exactly connected with the Heisenberg group. So let's recall the formulas. Lifting for a function which defined on homogeneous space is given by this expression. So for fixed character chi, we may expand our function from being defined on the homogeneous space to a function defined on the entire group. When having two functions on the homogeneous space, we may expand them both to the group and make a convolution on the group. Having a function obtained by the lifting, that will be a function from the averaged ideal, and so convolution will be again of two such function will be again a function from the averaged ideal, and this function really in one-to-one correspondence with certain functions on the homogeneous space, so we may pull back result of convolution, and that is the definition. So we just using that our square diagram to define convolution. So if we have here that lifting operator related to character, so we just define the twisted convolution as operation which are by lifting connected to the usual one. Well, let's take a look at that general formula. Again, it general formula can be defined not only for the Heisenberg group, it's a quite general construction. Well, let's see what its particular realization when we are dealing with averaging with respect to character related to the Heisenberg group center. So we consider that Heisenberg group, one-dimensional one, subgroup H is the center, corresponding character chi is the character of the center, this one. When plane substitution into the above formulas produce an expression which is given by the formula 43. So that is expression for the twisted convolution on the Heisenberg group. So looking on that formula, we may see the origin of its name. So it's do like we have a usual convolution on R2. So we have here expression in integral, which look like a usual convolution. But on top of it, there is certain weight. So it's convolution with weight or with the twist. And this twist is exactly connected to the symplectic form, which is important for the classical mechanics, differential form important for the classical mechanics. So this is the twisted convolution appeared on the Heisenberg group. And for moreover, if we are discussing application to the quantum mechanics, when we are not so interested in the composition of two operators, we are more interested in their commutator. So we may try to build a corresponding commutator. So commutator is AB minus BA. So for two functions K1 and K2, we may consider the commutator of corresponding operators. The operators which correspond to representation for integrated representation for function K1 and K2. When using previous results, what four functions define it on the homogeneous space, multiplication is intertwined with the twisted convolution, we find the formula for commutator in term of twisted convolution. So this is the formula in term of twisted convolution. Or if we explicitly use the previous identity 43 and just noted what swapping the order of function k1 and k2, so it does not affect that term in the product, so where we have product function k1 and k2, because that is like usual convolution on the Euclidean space, and usual convolution is commutative. The only things which changed, if we change order k1 and k2, this is the sign in the exponent. But if we have that exponent and we change a sign and subtract exponent with opposite sign, then due to well-known formula, Euler formula, exponent will generate the sine function. So in kernel in our convolution then shall be replaced from exponent to sine function. So this is what we obtained. Is a celebrated Moyle bracket in quantum mechanics. So this is a representation for the commutator of two functions, two observables defined on the phase space, and where commutator in term of certain integral transformation. So this is a Moyle bracket which we obtained for the Heisenberg group. When we are speaking about contravariant transform, which map any representation or identify any representation for a given group with the sub-representation of the left regular representation, it's always useful to discuss the inverse operation, or at least operation acting in opposite direction. So for covariant transform, a similar thing, dual thing, is known as contravariant transform. And in fact, this is a closely object which is closely related to integrated representation. So contravariant transform define it as follow. We already know what is the integrated representation. This is when we are taking a function f and integrate it with the representation over the group. So this is an operator which we obtain, integrating operator over the group, we obtain an operator. So we are just applying that operator to a particular vector, to a fixed vector, which called reconstructing vector. So initially, there is no need what reconstructing vector would be connected in any way, or in at least in direct way, to the mother wavelet, which we considered before. And in this context, mother wavelet maybe again have a name analyzing vector. So when we are doing, or when we are working in term of signal processing, wavelet transform may be treated as analysis of signal. We are using mother wavelet or analyzing vector to decompose our signal into certain frequencies or in certain localized signals. And when after analysis is done and maybe some filtering is done, when we cut off certain frequencies or when we remove certain locations of our signal in times frequency spectrum, we may want to reconstruct signal back after such filtering. And that is done by that formula, which is 45 here. We just apply again signal, modified signal F, to the representation and a certain reconstructing vector. So that is a formula. So again, meaning of this initial definition is just application of integrated representation to particular vector. Again, a calculation very similar to one which we did for covariant transform, again, almost identical three or four lines, demonstrate that contravariant transform, again, has intertwining property. So it's easy to verify that contravariant transform intertwine left regular representation and a representation row, but if you will compare it to the intertwining property for mother wavelet, so for mother wavelet, covariant transform, we have intertwining property that row G was intertwined with the left regular in this order, when for contravariant transform, we have intertwining representation in the opposite direction. So it will be rho gm. So now what happens if we will consider the composition of covariant and contravariant transform? So counting spaces where that transformation is defined, we may see what this is a map from initial space to the space B where our reconstructing vector B naught is cyclic. Cyclic vector means what if I apply all possible representation to this vector, then take all possible linear combination of the obtained images, when take the closure, I obtain the entire space. So this is cyclicity of vector. If our representation is irreducible, then any non-zero vector is a cyclic vector. So that is also follow immediately from the definition of irreducibility of representation. So combining these two intertwining properties, we may see that composition of M and WU intertwine rho first in this way. We have lambda G in between of two representation, and then finally second intertwining property implies that composition of contravariant and covariant transform intertwine rho with itself. But as we discussed when we considered representations where reducibility property and irreducibility, we said that a representation may be intertwined with itself only either as a multiple of identity or our representation is reducible if it's not a multiple of identity. This is so-called Schur lemma, a very important one, and really a key result in the representation theory of the group. And if you look for the proof, you will see that proof is based on the spectral theory for linear operators, and then that demonstrate one more a closer connection of representation theory with the theory of operator, with spectral theory, which we will touch a bit in this course as well. So based on the Schur lemma, we can make the conclusion what for irreducible representation rho, composition of covariant and contravariant transform shall be a multiple of identity. Well, multiple of identity may be just a zero operator as well. So that constant can happen to be zero if our analyzing vector and reconstructing vector are not in good agreement. If somehow they are orthogonal, then that constant can be equal to zero. That, of course, not an interesting and good case. And this is a situation which we will try always to avoid. But obtaining a non-trivial intertwining operator which is a multiple of identity with non-zero constant, that is interesting, important result for classification of representations. And we will use it in our course to make all classification of all irreducible representation for the Heisenberg group. Well, probably it's better to stop here because next portion is related to quantum mechanical picture which appear from the Heisenberg group. So we have some spare minutes to answer question if there is any question at the moment, or otherwise, are there any questions? Okay, then I hope to see you next week. Please don't forget to record your attendance on the lectures because it's really a good indicator if the lectures are good or not very good. So see you next week.